very good afternoon to one and all present here. They say to any entrepreneur, if you want to do it now. And if you don't, you're going to regret it. With this very notion and aspiration, today at Asian School of Business, we are hosting a yet another powerful session under the flagship corporate lecture series, Leadership and Entrepreneurship Aspiration Development Program. LEAD is an initiative of AEG which aims at developing and inculcating the leadership and entrepreneurship spirit among the young generation. Leadership and entrepreneurship development is a need of our and most necessary tool for sustainable development, business growth, employment generation, and empowerment. AEG LEAD invites top industry professionals wherein they share their high-valued experiences, guide students towards innovative thinking, benefits of new ventures, self-development, and attributes of being an effective and efficient leader. Few of the speakers under this program include Sri Pranab Mukherjee, Dr. Kiran Bedi, Mr. Sagar Dharyani, the founder of Our Momos, General Bikram Singh, former Chief of Army Staff of India, Mr. R. K. Somani, Managing Director, HSIL Limited, Mr. Philip Kotler, the father of modern marketing, Mr. Richard Reckey, former CEO, KPMG, and R. Gopalakrishnan, former Director, Tata Sons Limited, to name a few. Today's session shall be the most inspiring one, especially for those of you who wish to build your dreams through a startup and for those who want to do something big in life. We have amongst us a true illustration of a self-made man, one who is an inspiration to millions of people, and especially that audience which we have amongst today, the aspiring entrepreneurs. Yes, students, we're truly delighted to announce that we have amongst us none other than Mr. Sanjeev B. Chandani, founder, InfoEdge India Limited. Mr. Sanjeev B. Chandani is an Indian businessman who is the founder and executive vice chairman of InfoEdge, which owns Naukri.com, a job portal, as well as a co-founder of Ashoka University. He is a recipient of the Padma Shri Award, the fourth highest civilian award in India. He received this award in January 2020. He attended St. Columba's School, Delhi, and finished schooling there in 1981. Thereafter, he obtained a Bachelor's of Arts degree in Economics in 1984, and he completed his MBA from IIM Ahmedabad in 1989. Mr. Sanjeev, after his PG, left a job marketing holics at HMM, which is now known as GlaxoSmithKline, in 1990 to set up two companies, IndiaMark and InfoEdge, along with a partner. In 1997, Mr. B. Chandani set up Naukri.com, jobs portal on a server in the United States, and later Quadrangle, an offline executive search business. In 2005, Naukri.com was reported as being India's largest web-based employment site. Building up in the website's business, InfoEdge later launched other classified sites such as 99 Acres in real estate, Jeevan Sathi in matrimony, and Shiksha in the education sector. He is also an astute investor, having invested in unicorns like Policy Bazaar and Zomato. Additionally, he is a part of the Vision Circle of Foundation for Young Innovators, a Shark Tank for social initiatives exclusively open to high school students. He won the Ernest Chin Young Entrepreneur of the Year Award in 2008, and you all will be amazed to know that Sir ranked 68th number in Forbes India Rich List 2020 with a net worth of US$2.1 billion. An excellent speaker, a great source of inspiration, and an illustration of hard work and smart thinking. We welcome you, sir, at Asian Education Group.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me here.
Thank you, sir. So we can start with a question and answer round with you, because our students have so many questions. They're so inquisitive and they want to really know each and every bit of your life, your professional life, and how did you achieve so much? So to start with, our students are excited to listen that one of the pioneer entrepreneurs, how did you start this journey? And please share a few words about your journey.
So after working in the corporate sector for about 5 years, you know, in 1989-90, I decided that I didn't want to be an executive in a large corporation. I would much rather start something of my own, even if it's small. At least I'll have independence, I'll have the freedom to create, and I'll be my own boss. And with that intent, I quit my job in 1990. And from a servant quarter above the garage in my father's house, we started doing salary surveys and then did a couple of trademark databases. And that's how life began, with very little money in a servant quarter, using a secondhand computer, which he bought, you know, from a newspaper ad, classified ad, and secondhand furniture, again, you know, bought from through a classified advertisement in a for sale column. We started off with 2,000 rupees. And we gradually built this company, and we got revenue. We broke even. We launched new products. We couldn't take a salary. For the first 10 years, I couldn't take a salary for 6 years. But we slowly clawed our way up to profitability at a reasonable size. And then in 1997, after drifting and doing maybe 20 small things for 7 years, we launched Naukri. And Naukri in 97 was, again, one more small idea, right? After 20 small ideas, the 21st small idea. And it happened to be a right place, right time, worked hard, worked smart, got lucky. The internet took off, we took off. We raised venture capital in the year 2000. And the company grew and became sizable, became profitable. And we listed in 2006. So it started off with very modest beginnings, with a very little amount of capital. And the willingness to rough it out and do whatever it took to survive.
So probably through harsh days to the most successful days, I believe you've carried all through it. So we want to understand that what are the major traits which differentiate a businessman from an entrepreneur?
Well, an entrepreneur is also a businessman, right? So it's kind of interchangeable. But really, there's a certain kind of entrepreneur whom venture capitalists like to fund. Number one, they're in the knowledge economy. Number two, they're very often entrepreneurs. Their families have not been in business earlier. Number three, they're very often educated. They have choices. They could have got a job at a private organization and a large multinational, but they chose to quit it and do this instead. The new entrepreneurs are very often innovative. They use technology. So that's a kind of entrepreneur that's emerged in India in the last 10, 15, 20 years. And those are the kind of entrepreneurs who are building big companies from scratch.
Great. So it's said that you learn a lot while working in startups, but the dynamic nature of that setup is very challenging at times. So what are your views on the same?
No, you learn a lot everywhere. I learned a lot working for 5 years in a large corporation, or two large corporations. The key is to learn a lot wherever you are. Okay, so large organizations teach you systems, they teach you scale, they teach you how to be a good boss, they teach you processes, right?
Right.
Startups teach you how to be flexible, how to be, doing everybody's job at the same time, how to be good at all jobs, and so on. So they teach you different things. The key is to work with good people who teach you a lot. Most of all, you learn from people, wherever you are, whether you are a startup or you are in a large corporation, you learn from people. So are you working with good people? Are you working with smart people? Are you learning a lot? Whether the organization is large, small, or it's a startup or not.
Okay, great. So how has been your journey as a student at IIM Ahmedabad? And what were the two key learnings which you learned from there?
So, look, IIM Ahmedabad was a cauldron and a melting pot where it was immediately obvious to me that, look, I did not realize there's so many smart people in the world at the same time, because so many people are smarter than me, right? And I learned a lot from my classmates. I learned a lot working from them. I learned a lot just observing them. I learned a lot listening to them in class and in study groups. So I think it's important to go to a management school or a business school where there are lots of other smart people. Because you learn a lot from your cohort, from your peer group.
Right.
So at IIM, I think we learned the value of hard work. You had to really work hard to get through, to get by, to do well in that place. we learned the value of working with others in groups. I think these two things we learned, hard work and working with people.
Okay, great. I think these are the two most valuable things which students should actually learn, and they help a lot all throughout their lives. So there's a student who has a question that I have a business idea, but I don't have the money. My family and peers advise me to look for a secure job rather than taking an entrepreneurship risk. So how should I handle such a situation?
I think the first thing is to get clarity in your own head. What is it that you want to do?
Mm-hmm.
Right? Now, if you decide you want to do entrepreneurship, then have a conversation with your family and friends and explain to them how you want to do it, why it seems risky, but it's not so. And even if you do take a risk and it fails, you can always come back to a job if that is the case, or you can do something else. First thing is to you be clear in your head as to do you want to be an entrepreneur or not. If you're sure, what are the reasons why? Understand the risks, mitigate the risk, have a conversation with your family and friends. Explain to them your plans, explain why you think it's not as risky as they think it is. Explain what your fallback plan is, plan B, in case it fails, what do you do? And only then take a call. But do not become an entrepreneur. Do not leave your job without thinking it through.
Okay, great. I think that's a great advice for our students. So we also have some students with us live on this panel. They would like to keep their questions across to you. So the first one is Sonali Sethi. Sonali, can you please enable your camera?
Good afternoon, sir.
Hi, Sonali. Sonali, if you speak closer to your microphone, I can't hear you.
So now I'm audible?
It's very soft, but I'll try and hear you.
So my question is, people say an idea can change your life. Do you believe in this? What came to your mind while starting an e-commerce company, while e-commerce was not very prominent during that time?
So look, I believe that an idea can change your life, but an idea that's executed well can change your life, not just an idea. So execution and doing it and making it happen is what is sometimes more important than the idea. Idea alone is not enough. You need a good idea, but you need to execute it well. Look, when we started Naukri, there were just 14,000 internet accounts in the country, right? We had no idea where the internet would go. We could not envision it, right? It just seemed like a good, nifty, small idea. So I had done 20 experiments. It's my 21st experiment. It happened to be the right one, right? So I got lucky, right? But a friend of mine, Niren Chaudhary, who was to be the head of Pizza Hut and KFC in India, had called me once a few years ago to give a talk to his senior management. And I said, I got lucky. And the end of it, Niren stood up and said, yeah, he got lucky. But let's understand something about luck. Luck is about being in the right place at the right time. Right? But if you're in enough places, enough times, sooner or later, you will be in the right place at the right time. Right, which means that you got to keep trying. So persistence is, I think, the greatest secret of success for most entrepreneurs. Keep at it. Show up every day. Work at it. Sooner or later, good things will happen.
Thank you, sir.
I guess a lesson for our students, not losing it. Time and again, they have to process forward. Sir, basis on a study, 90% of Indian startups or startups in general fail within 5 years of their inception, despite being a sustainable business idea. What are your views on the same, and what pieces of advice would you like to give to entrepreneurs so that they achieve success in their ventures?
So what I'd like to say is dream big, but start small.
Mm-hmm.
The reason why you start small is because you were then taking lower risks, losing less money, figuring it out when it's not too expensive to make a mistake. So, you may have a big dream, but that may take 10, 15 years to realize. Start small and then grow it slowly. And then when you're sure you've got the model right, that is when you actually step on the accelerator and say, okay, now I can grow fast and big. Right? Don't try and grow fast and big on day one.
Mm-hmm.
Number one. Number two is, look, while your business may fail or may not succeed, The question is, as an entrepreneur, will you succeed?
Yeah.
So for the first 7 years, we drifted and did a bunch of small things. We weren't successful, we weren't failures, we were surviving. After 7 years, we launched Naukri and we succeeded. So keep at it. You know, the first 20 ideas maybe remain small, maybe you abandon them. So those businesses may not have succeeded. But eventually we succeeded.
True. So I think it's again about being persistent, as you said. So, sir, when you say start small, are you talking about cutting costs initially?
Cutting costs, yes, but not cutting corners.
Mm-hmm.
So be frugal.
Okay.
Right? Don't pay yourself a salary. Go without. Mm-hmm. Don't have a fancy office. Right? Maybe hire two but work it as yourself. Right? So I have done stuff like in the beginning we spoke to direct mail. I have been to the post office myself, carrying 10,000 letters and running them through a franking machine myself with the assistance of one of our peers. I could delegate it, hire 3 people. It would cost more money. So be prepared to do the dirty work yourself. It's okay.
And surely that's very important as an entrepreneur. We have another question here. So Sakshi Chaudhary is with us. Sakshi, you can put your question across.
Good afternoon, sir. Firstly, thank you so much for having with us today. My question to you is, sir, that what changes in hiring trends you have noticed in pre and post pandemic as an employer?
I think post pandemic, people are a lot more cautious. A lot of people are not hiring. If they're hiring, they're hiring very, very carefully, very cautiously. And therefore, the number of new jobs being created is much, much less than before. Now, as the economy recovers, we expect and hope that the situation will improve, right? We are seeing that, look, people who are getting job offers may not be getting large increases or any increase from their current salary. We also know that it's hardest at the entry level to get a job right now, right? So unless you're in a very particular sector with a very specific skill you're bringing to the table, that's in demand, it's quite hard right now to get a job.
So probably as a solution, as you say, that very relevant skill or skill which is, least available, can we know if there are any particular courses or any particular skill set which our students should work upon to fetch a good job in this new normal?
So look, what the advice I like to give to people who are just finishing business school, where placements are hard, right, is assume you've done an MBA for one extra year.
Mm-hmm.
But in that one extra year, add a skill, do an internship, get some work experience on your resume.
Mm-hmm.
Even if you don't get the salary you're looking for, even if it's a free internship, but that work experience is important. So that after 6 months, 12 months, 1 year, 15 months, that work experience counts and gets you a job somewhere. So even if it's a free internship, go ahead and do it. Assume that you're on a year longer. It's an unfortunate scenario, the kind of economic contraction that we're seeing this year.
Right.
So it's going to be hard. We are all facing it. But I guarantee you, 5 years from now, you look back and you will wear this like a badge of honor that you came through this period.
Mm-hmm.
Right? It's a bit like, going through World War II. And then afterwards, if you survive, when you survive, those who survive, we look back on it and, they said it was an achievement.
A survivor indeed. So do you think India is startup ready and how should we strengthen the entrepreneurial ecosystem here?
I think India is startup ready. That's why you're seeing so many startups. Mm-hmm. And I also think that some of the schemes of the government are very good, whether it is a fund of fund for startups, whether it is all the enabling laws to encourage more startups. Now, can India be more startup ready than it already is? Yes, of course. That's a question of continuous improvement, right? But that's an ongoing thing. But India is startup ready.
And how can we strengthen this entrepreneurial ecosystem in India, to be specific?
So I think it's already happening. Okay, mm-hmm. I think some of it is government related. A lot of it is not government related. A lot of it is in society, in families, where you know, parental expectations are changing. Parents don't mind now if their children are doing startups. 20, 30 years ago, that was not the case.
Sure.
20, 30 years ago, the aspirational jobs were large multinationals, you know, jobs that were overseas, jobs in a safe or government jobs.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Those jobs remain aspirational, but entrepreneurship has got added on to one more thing to do, which is aspirational. And that is the biggest change, more than anything the government has done.
Mm-hmm. Great. So related to this only, as a student also asked about the jobs and will they be available, students usually have another question in mind that if we have two offers in hand, one is from a reputed multinational organization and another is a startup. So which one should we go for?
There are no formulas. It depends what you want to do. It depends which startup you're talking about. It depends which job. But I would say you go for that job where in the first 2 or 3 years, you will learn the most. Mm-hmm. Where you'll be working with smart people.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Because just as in the first 3 or 4 years of a child's life, the learning is the most, the first 3 or 4 years of your professional career, the learning is the most. And those, what you do in those 3 or 4 years, who you work with, which company, doing what job, that will more or less determine your work ethic, your work attitude, and yourself the rest of your professional life. The first 3 or 4 years are very important. You don't go for money, you don't go for anything else, you go for learning.
Learning, true. Indeed. So related to this, do you think that scalability is the most important factor in the success of a venture?
Not necessarily. You can have a very good small startup. The issue is, does it meet your goals? Mm-hmm. Are you making an impact? Are you finding meaning in it? Are you able to defend it against competition?
Mm-hmm.
Right? So there, you can run a very good small business also. It's fine. But yes, if you want to raise venture capital money, they will want scale because they want a 10x, 20x, 50x return.
Okay. So with this, we have another student with us, Aman. Aman, you can put your question across. Please enable your video. Aman, are you there, connected? Please enable your video. Yes.
Good afternoon, sir.
Hi.
Sir, my question to you is that we always study about Japanese and American style of management. Sir, what is Indian style of management? And what do you think, what is the reason behind the failure of Neckman's startup?
So, I don't think there's a particular Indian style of management. I think a lot of these labels, you know, Japanese style of management, this style of management, they're just labels. These are fancy things that management school profs, some who are doing some research, want to write a book and put it in a pigeonhole and said, this is what they do, right? So you've heard of the word jugaad, right? So jugaad was common slang, right? Until Harvard discovered it. And somebody wrote an article in Harvard Business Review, some American prof saying jugaad. Jugaad is the Indian innovation, right? And it's been with us for centuries, right? And there's no big deal, right? But I don't think you should get fooled by jargon. I don't think you should get fooled by any of that. I think you should do what makes sense. Above all, stay close to your customer and understand your customer's needs. Second, be good to your employees. Make sure you're working well in a team, right? Number three, be well governed, pay your taxes, follow the laws, and you'll be fine. And then you can call it any style of management, it's fine.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much, sir.
So you're working in an oligopolistic market, which is a highly competitive environment. So how do you manage to keep your brands ahead of the competition?
I think if you spend a lot of time, effort, attention in understanding your customer better, and mm-hmm. you are continuously close to your customer, and you invest in improving your product, your service, your offerings, based on the feedback you get from the customer, and based on the insights you get from your customer, right, which is what we do, you'll stay ahead of competition. So you should be customer focused, not competitive focused.
I think that's the key which most of the brands are focusing today. Customer oriented, client oriented. Right. So our students really want to know that what is a typical day of the Sanjeev Bikchandani?
Right now, it's mostly on Zoom calls through the day. Mm-hmm. Occasionally, somebody comes over with some papers to sign. But mm-hmm. it's largely Zoom calls and meetings. I think we are still working from home as an organization. Right? Mm-hmm. Prior to that, it was, you get up and you start looking at your mail, doing your phone calls, you go to office, and then you're through the day doing meetings. Mm-hmm. Sometimes in office, sometimes outside office. And you're meeting startups, you're meeting your internal team members, you're figuring it out. And then, you know, before you know it, the day's over.
So everything is rush, we believe. Okay. So when you came up with the idea of creating an Indian matrimonial portal, which in itself was quite a revolutionary idea back then, how did you tackle the conservative and traditional mindsets of Indian parents and overcome the emotional barrier associated with online matrimony?
Well, actually, we didn't make a special effort to overcome any barriers. We simply floated Jeevan Sathi as one more experiment. It's a free experiment. Mm-hmm. And put it on the net and gave it a link from the Naukri homepage and said, let's see what happens. And it began to work, right? And sure, there must have been some people who were diffident. Mm-hmm. But so long as there were enough who were okay trying it out, you know, we were making progress, continuously chipping away. But it's been 22 years since Jeevan Sathi was launched. Mm-hmm. Right? So things take time, but you chip away at it and it happens.
Okay. Sir, so you are an inspiration and role model for lot many youngsters, I would say. Who is your role model?
I don't have any one role model. I think I have learned different things from different people. Mm-hmm. As I've gone along working, right? From my teachers, my family, my parents, my first job, my elder brother, my elder sister, you know, my former bosses and colleagues, my colleagues today, the startups, you know, we invest in those entrepreneurs. Mm-hmm. So I think you've got to learn from everybody and, you know, learn, and, you know, and you'll pick up things along the way. You don't need one role model.
Right. So you believe, truly believe in learning and learning from everybody who comes across.
You learn from life.
That's true. We have amongst us our student, Siddhant. Siddhant, can you please enable your camera and put your question across?
Greetings of the day, sir. So my question to you is that what is your plan to maintain your position in the dynamically changing environment due to the COVID-19 pandemic, and how do you plan to retain the existing clientele base and expand at the same time?
So look, I think one good thing that we have going for us as a company is that Naukri is a 55 to 60% EBITDA margin product. That means even at 40% negative growth, we are still breaking even. Right? That gives us a luxury. That gives us a luxury of that we did not have to downsize or ask anybody to go because of the pandemic. We have not cut salaries, right? It gives us that luxury. But the reason why we have such high profit margins is because we built a great product. The reason why we built a great product is because we really understood the customer. And we've got some really smart people working alongside us to build those products. Back to staying close to the customer, making sure you've got a great team, making that team work well, right? Innovating to solve the customer's problems. And if you do all of that, and for the last 23 years since we launched Naukri, we've been doing that. All of that has fructified into the situation where we are today, where you know, we are able to make the kind of profits we do so that we have the luxury of not sacking people in the pandemic, the luxury of not cutting salaries in the pandemic. So focus on the customer, innovate, and making sure that you've got good people in the company. And it'll be all right.
Thank you so much, sir.
So just from this, as you said, we should, as an employer, always make sure that we have good people in our company. So like, we have so many students who will be entering the work field. How do you define a good candidate? And if you had to hire a management student, what qualities will you look at?
It depends what job. But typically, we would hire MBAs in sales and customer relationship jobs. Right? And there, I think the right kind of work ethic, work attitude, humility, ability to be good with people, work as a team, being humble enough to serve your customer, those things become important. I think working hard and being diligent to be able to understand the product and service you're selling.
Right.
Okay, those are a few qualities to look for.
So I think a bad mix of soft skills and hard skills.
A good mix of that, yeah.
Okay, great. So how does it feel to have received the fourth highest civilian award, the Padma Shri? And what was the moment all about? How was it?
Well, okay, first of all, I've not got the award yet. My name is on the list. The award has not been given because of COVID. They postponed the ceremony. But yes, my name is on the list. Right?
Yes, Google says that, sir.
Okay. Now, the second thing, I wasn't expecting it. I didn't know it was going to happen. Right? And yes, it came as a very, very pleasant surprise. I've tweeted about it also. But the truth is, I didn't do this alone. So, you know, I may be called on stage to take the applause, to give a speech. But this is the effort of several thousand people. We have 4,500 people in the company. We have had several thousand who have passed through the company earlier, been there and moved on. So the achievement of the company is a outcome of several thousand people's effort. And therefore, if you know, I have been given an award, it is not really just my effort. It is the effort of lots of other people. It is also the effort of those startups whom we invested in as a company, because they've also contributed to the growth of our company. So the founders, Zomato, Policy Bazaar, all the other companies invested in, it is their achievement also.
Great. So, sir, today since morning, we've been discussing entrepreneurship with our students. We have our own EDIC cell, and all our BBA, BCA or PGDM students, they want to become an entrepreneur in future. With that, I want to understand that to become an entrepreneur, do you feel that a skill set is enough or a mindset is required? And we want a piece of advice from you that from where should they start?
So there is no formula. There are people who dropped out of business school and became entrepreneurs. There are people who didn't go to business school and became entrepreneurs. There are people who dropped out of school and became entrepreneurs. And there are people like me who worked, who got the formal education, worked for 5 years, then became entrepreneurs. Right? So there is no one formula. Right? You will know when you are ready. You will know. It's like falling in love. What's the right time to fall in love? The right way to fall in love? I don't know yet. There is no one right way. There's no one right time. Okay? But you will know when it happens. And you will know, I love this idea, I don't love this idea. You will know, hey, I want to get out of my job, I'm sick of it. You will know, hey, this idea is calling me. The time has come.
Sure. So as you say, that luck also matters. It plays an important role.
Luck matters. But like I said, you know, if you try, if you're very lucky, you'll succeed in 5 years. If you're moderately lucky, you'll succeed in 10 years. If you're very unlucky, you'll succeed in 15 years. So keep at it.
But you have to think from a very long-term perspective. So 5 years, 10 years.
Absolutely. I've met very few entrepreneurs who succeeded on day one.
Yeah, true.
But I can't think of anybody.
So Naukri.com is very unique, as we say, and as we all know. And at that time when it got invented, there was nothing like that in the market. So relevant. So what do you think makes Naukri.com now different in the current times, different from other job portals? And what were the key success points for this venture?
I think Naukri, I believe that successful businesses are built on deep customer insights. Right. Now, one of the insights that I had early on in my last job, right, when I was working in HMM, I used to observe all my colleagues who would read Business India from the back, because there were 35 to 40 pages of appointment ads at the back of Business India. Right. And that insight told me that jobs are a high interest category of information. People prefer to look at jobs before they read the articles. Right? And that is where the idea of Naukri germinated. This is 1990. This is before the internet. Just an insight.
Mm-hmm.
When I saw the internet for the first time in 1996, October, this insight came back to me and said, if we just take jobs from newspapers and magazines around the country, put them all in one place and keep them live and current for 30 days, this website traffic aayega. Aapko advertise karne ki zarurat nahi padegi. Because people will find the site. And people will talk about it, go viral. Jisko aajkal virality kehte hain, us samay that was based on that insight. Right. And that's what happened. We got 29 newspapers from around the country and magazines into our office every day. And we just take the job ads and rehash them in our own words and put them up and keep them live for 30 days.
Mm-hmm.
And traffic began to come. Right. So it's based on that customer insight. So, Deepinder Goyal, founder of Zomato,
mm-hmm.
when I met him for the first time, I asked me, idea kahan se aaya? And he said, look, I was working in Bain Consulting in Gurgaon. Now, Bain was this big MNC consulting company where there were maybe 50, 60 people working, mostly young, mostly male. They would work long hours. They had to eat lunch and dinner in the office very often. They wouldn't get food from home. Office had a cafeteria that would not serve food. But you could bring your own food and have it. So in order to make life easy for the employees, the admin team had collated delivery menu cards of 80 restaurants that will deliver to their location. And they would keep them in a file folder in the cafeteria. And the pillar would say, yaar, ek baje line lag jati thi to access that file folder. Meko adha ghanta lagta tha to, and then I could see 30 seconds and then figure out what I wanted to order. I came on Saturday to office and I scanned all these menu cards and I put them on my personal page on the office intranet. 2 days later, IT infra guy came to me and said, what have you done? How come all the internal traffic is going to your page?
Mm-hmm.
And he said, that's when the penny dropped. And I realized that aggregation of menu cards has got value. And so I went to restaurants around the city on weekends and picked up the menu cards. And when I had 800, mm-hmm. I launched a site called Food eBay, which changed his name from Zomato. Now it's called Zomato, but when he launched, it's called Food eBay. And I put up 800 restaurant menu cards and their addresses and a few photographs and their geographical locations. Yeah.
So I think very rightly said that an entrepreneur is more like a coordinator also who brings things on a platter and puts them across in a lucrative way. So when you had this idea of your own startup InfoEdge and then Naukri.com, you left a very lucrative job at that time. So what was your family's reaction? Were they very okay with it?
No, my family was, I was very fortunate. I have a very supportive family. Nobody put pressure on me. Nobody mm-hmm. said, hey, you know, you're supposed to earn money. Why are you leaving a safe job? They said, yeah, we support you in what you want to do. I think entrepreneurs in India need supportive families, especially first generation entrepreneurs.
Mm-hmm. Okay. It is said that there is a high skill gap in India. So what skills do you think should be enhanced when we talk about a management professional?
So look, I think people skills, I think numeracy skills, analytical skills, I think the ability and willingness to work hard,
mm-hmm.
the understanding that earlier on in your career, first 5, 7, 10 years, you will not be a leader, you'll be a follower.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, possessing the humility to follow, being willing to do whatever work, the most operational work, the most tedious work, drudgery, and still doing it well and enthusiastically. I think those are the kind of things that are important early on.
Sure. So we can have another student with us right now, Vatsala. So you can put your question across.
A very good afternoon, sir.
Hi.
I am audible.
Yes.
Okay. So firstly, sir, I would like to mention it's a pleasure meeting you, although virtually, but it's really nice. So, sir, my question is, in the era of having a job and settling down, you opted for quitting an organization like Horlicks and starting your two companies of your own. So what were the ideas and the thoughts and the thought process you went through initially that came to your mind when you started as an entrepreneur rather than being a job seeker?
No, I was very scared. You know, I'm from a middle-class family. My father was in the government, mom was a homemaker. You know, there was no savings, right? There was no family wealth. So I was really scared. Okay. And for the first 2 years, I was kind of paralyzed with fear. And, you know, and I didn't take a salary for the first 3 years. I began to teach on weekends at management schools. Basically, I had a good CV. Then Stevens College, I'm Ahmedabad, two multinationals, right? I leveraged that CV and I began to teach as a visiting faculty in marketing at management school around Delhi, so I could earn some pocket money, right? And slowly, 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 we built the business.
Thank you so much, sir.
So we see that many people are being very overstressed about their life at corporate and how to balance out the work-life scenarios. So how do you achieve that? And if at all, you have to give some suggestions that how to maintain a work-life balance.
Nikki, if you're a startup entrepreneur and you want to succeed, I think it may be fashionable to say it's important to have work-life balance, but forget about work-life balance. Your work is your life.
Work is life, right?
Okay. So Sagar Daryani, who you mentioned earlier, Sagar is an entrepreneur I have personally invested behind. I like him. Good guy. Mm-hmm. So I was on a panel discussion with him, and he was asked the same question. Saying, Sagar, how do you maintain work-life balance? He said, if you're a startup entrepreneur, there is no work-life balance. There is only work-life integration.
Right.
So look, a startup will consume you. You don't own the startup. The startup owns you.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So don't do a startup half-heartedly.
Wholeheartedly, and I think with all the priorities put in there, at least for first few years, as you say. Right. So COVID has raised the efficiency expectations of most of the companies. So how can a fresher who's not that experienced cope up with these expectations of the industry now?
So look, the challenge is if you're working from home, right, as many people are, many companies are, then you're working on your own. And which means you better be a self-starter, better be a good communicator, better understand what people who assign you work want from you. And then you better. If, on the other hand, your organization has begun to go back to work and offices are open, but there's still social distancing, right? You've got to maybe work twice as hard and twice as smart to deliver what people want without them having to
brief you that, yeah,
or be able to supervise you closely. So if you are in a job in COVID, you have independence, but you still have to deliver.
Sure. Sir, this one is our most favorite, and I think we really want you to tell us and, tell us how it works, because in this fiercely competitive world, we feel that ethics are probably not playing a very major role, but businesses require ethics to survive. What is your take on this? What is the role of ethics?
All good companies, all good entrepreneurs are ethical. Well, if you're not ethical, you can't last 20 years, 30 years, 50 years. You can't build an organization that lasts that long. Right? And what I'm also saying is, if you're ethical, investors value you better. So enough people have told me, enough investors, shareholders of ours, big institutions in America, have told me that we are probably getting a significant corporate governance premium in our share price. So it pays to be ethical. But it pays over the long run.
So usually when we talk to students, they don't understand, and especially that we have a lot of undergraduate students who are starting their college with us from today. This is their orientation day. So what is ethics for a student? And I mean, if they have to imbibe that in their conduct and behavior, what should they do?
First thing, be honest in your work. No cheating, no plagiarism. No collaboration that's not been authorized by the institute. Your work should be your work. Should be independent.
Right.
Right. So if you're honest with your work every day in college, that's good enough to start with.
Great. So honesty is the key, students. Many people are coming up with many different business ideas today, and some end up touching a great success, successful heights, and some don't. So what, according to you, is a great way to come up with an idea, and what are the characteristics of a great idea, according to you, which shall work?
A great idea is one that solves an unsolved problem. And whose unsolved problem? Your prospective customer's unsolved problem, the person who will pay you. Mm-hmm. So if you are solving an unsolved problem, your customer should be willing to pay you. You won't have to sell, the customer will buy on his own. Mm-hmm. So focus on figuring out what the unsolved problems of your prospective customer is or are. Right? But to do that, you have to go back to what I said earlier, which is stay close to your customers. Observe them, talk to them, listen to them. Perhaps you've been a customer yourself and you've had this problem.
Mm-hmm.
But figure out what the unsolved problem is.
And from here that you've figured out so many unsolved problems in the past and have invested in such great ventures. Now, if at all you need to venture in new business lines, what would it be? Looking at this new normal.
Well, look, I have stopped thinking of business ideas myself.
Okay.
But we invest behind startups and their ideas. So I assess other people's ideas today and I don't come out with my own ideas.
Okay, great. So we have another student with us, Yukta. Yukta, you can put your question across.
So good afternoon, sir. So my question is, how to identify the potential investment opportunities being an entrepreneur? And what was your thought process while investing in Policy Bazaar and Zomato?
So our thought process was, we have good people, good teams, solving an unsolved problem, getting traction already. The idea made sense to me. Right? And that's how we went in.
Okay, thank you.
So we have a very small section here, which is a rapid fire section. And we'll ask few questions and we expect you to give honest and rapid answers to them. So first question is, who or what is your motivation in life?
Well, my motivation is to build an organization that outlives me. That's world-class, world-scale out of India.
Okay. And if you'll say, who is your motivation then?
Well, my customer.
Okay, great. If you have to rank the following in order of importance, where one is the most important and three is the least important, how will you rank them? First one is money, fame, and success.
Actually, neither. Okay. None of them are important. Those are all outcomes. Those are happy, incidental outcomes of doing something you love. So I think meaning is the most important. It's not in those three choices.
Okay. The second option is skill, aptitude, and interest.
I think interest, because if you're interested in something, mm-hmm. you will do more of it.
Mm-hmm.
And if you do more of it, you develop your aptitude and you develop your skill.
Okay. So interest is most important. So can interest be developed according to you? Being an entrepreneur, we want to understand.
Well, I mean, I guess interest arises out of exposure to an idea, exposure to an activity, exposure to a body of knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
And then you put your toe in it and then you find you like it, then you do more of it. So it's developed.
Okay.
I'm willing to bet. How many males in the audience?
So probably 60%.
60%? I'm willing to bet 90% of them are interested in cricket. How many 40% women are willing to bet 70% of them are interested in cricket, if not playing it, at least watching it.
Yes, true.
Now, how do their interest develop? Were they born with it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Some of them played it.
Probably it also comes from the people around who are so interested and that ignites an interest in you as well. Okay, if not work, what will be a perfect balanced day for you? And work is not included here.
I guess reading and maybe some writing.
Okay, great. So how were your college days and college life? What kind of a student you were and what kind of activities you participated in?
I would say I was an above average student.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But not outstanding. I don't think I worked hard enough to be outstanding. I also were in St. Stephen's College and IIM Ahmedabad in a class mm-hmm. with so many really smart people, many of them smarter than me.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I could not be outstanding. I was not outstanding. Okay. I would participate in many, many activities, whether it is quizzing, whether it is some sport,
mm-hmm.
And whether it was bird watching or trekking or wildlife.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great.
I would dabble in that. I was not great at activity. I would dabble in that.
So probably here also you were looking forward to learning all the time.
But no, I mean, I enjoyed the activity.
Mm-hmm.
But I was not an expert in anything.
Okay.
Actually, if you were to ask me, what was I expert in?
Mm-hmm.
Both at... in college and my MBA, I would say nothing. I was not an expert in anything, but I was half good at most things.
So shall we say an expert who was expert at nothing is a master in everything today?
Well, no, I mean, I think as an entrepreneur, you have to have all-around skills.
Mm-hmm.
So you need 360 exposure. I got 360 degree exposure both in college and in IIM.
Sure. Great. So what has been the most memorable moment of your lifetime?
I wouldn't say there's one memorable moment, but I would say the building of Naukri, the creation of Naukri, the growing of Naukri, that has been a big achievement for the organization,
mm-hmm.
for me and my colleagues.
Great. I'm sure that would be one. Of course, we were expecting that. And we've seen a lot of your interviews, we've seen your videos. There you've always spoken about the support of your wife, your better half, and that you also mentioned that for first few years she was earning and you were busy introspecting and doing a lot of things. So what is her role in your life?
I think like I said, entrepreneurs have been very supportive families, and I've mm-hmm. had the support of my family, my parents, my wife, my kids, in my endeavors.
Okay, great. Sir, one last question here. We want you to give a message to all the AG students who attended this session here with us.
So I think, look, these are unprecedented times. Don't panic. Things will get better. Things shall pass. You'll come out of it. It'll be all right. Let's hang on in there.
Okay, so with this much of, I would say, positivity that you're assuring things will be all right and we should all keep going and this persistence. We would like to wrap up this session, sir, and I want to express that it was an honor to have you amongst us today. On behalf of the directors, the faculty members, and the students, I express and I put across this vote of thanks to you for being here with us, and we would like to acknowledge your presence with a memento. Thank you so much for being part of this family, sir, and we look forward to a continued association with you.
Thank you very much. Bye.
Thank you so much for connecting, sir. Bye.